Good morning, everyone. Hi, how are y'all doing? My name's Helen Elizabeth. If you haven't been here before, hi, how are you? So if you haven't been here before, I basically just do a Bible study every Saturday morning at 9:50, and we talk about all different topics. And on Wednesdays, we do a coffee and combo where we talk just about more so life topics, and it kind of correlates with whatever I talk about on Saturdays, but sometimes it's just whatever we want to talk about. But today we're going to be covering 2 Corinthians 4, and I'm so excited that you're here. We just basically start every Saturday with a prayer, and then I read to you, or I'll read the chapter, and then we discuss. So why don't you start out with the prayer, and then we'll get started. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for this time that we get to spend together. Lord, I'm so thankful that you've created something that allows me to talk to so many people from across the world. Lord, that's just such an amazing blessing. I pray that you would give me wisdom to share with these people as I read from 2 Corinthians. Lord, I pray that you would soften their hearts so that they would hear what you have to say. Thank you so much for everything you do for us, Lord. We love you. Amen. Amen. So, like I said before, we are going through 2 Corinthians 4. My house is kind of loud right now because there's a guy weed eating, but hopefully that won't be an issue for much longer. So, anyway, so if you have your Bible, turn to 2 Corinthians 4. Right now I'm using the ESV, so if you have that version, you can get that. If not, then you can just follow along with me. So 2 Corinthians 4. Therefore, having the ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart, but we have renounced disgraceful ways, or disgraceful and underhanded ways. We refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ is Lord, with ourselves as our servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of the darkness," has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies. For we who live are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. Since we have the same spirit of faith according to what has been written, "I believe and so I spoke," we also believe and so we also speak, knowing that he who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and bring us with you into his presence. For it is all for your sake, so that a grace extends to more and more people and may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. All right, so there's a couple of topics I kind of want to talk about in here, but before we get to the happy ones, I kind of want to start with the sad one just so we can get it out of the way. I know when I became a small group leader, we were going through Romans, and it was talking about how, like, predestination, and like, or do some people get chosen to be Christians and some people don't, and, you know, why do some people go to hell and some people don't? That was always really hard for me. I wanted to know more about that and why that was. And it kind of talks about this. And I had luckily a small group leader. He was awesome. Like, where I was a small group leader, but he was like the pastor that was over all the college ministry. And I talked to him a lot about this, and he talked to me a little bit about, you know, in the Old Testament, when Pharaoh basically talked to Moses and was like, "I'm not going to believe anything that you say." And he kept saying no, to a point that God finally said, "You know what? If you're not going to hear me, if you're not going to try to see me, you know, then I'm done." And kind of what we decided on, what my pastor and I kind of decided on, was not that God just says, "Okay, you're in, you're out, you're in, you're out." Not like that. But more so, he's talking about, okay, I'm going to try to show you. So say you and I, we go to our friends, we talk to them about Christ, we try to show them Christ, we try to do this over and over and over and over and over. And they choose to say, I refuse to know God. I will not believe. I will not do this. There's a point that God doesn't reject them, but he basically says, all right, I'll leave the veil over your face. And we talked about before about veils and how like God takes veils over our faces. Whenever we become Christians, the veil is lifted. And when the veil is lifted, all of a sudden you're like, wow, look at everything bad. Like you start realizing everything that you were doing before and you start thinking, oh my gosh, how did I live this way? I mean, I know when I was in graduate school and I told y'all about my transformation, you know, like when I was going through my life transformation and I was sitting there just like listening to God, all of a sudden everything that I had done, like it just hit me. What I had done and how much I had just rejected God. And I told y'all before, if you've been here before, I told you that I like tried to cover myself up with pillows. Like I literally was a child that freaked out realizing God saw me, knew everything I had done. And I had a veil over my face that had just been lifted and I just wanted to cover myself up. I kind of feel like that's probably what Adam and Eve felt like. And when all of a sudden you're like, you realize everything that you've been doing and you just feel naked. That's how I felt. But there's some people, I think, and when we try and we want this for them and that we try to show them Christ, that just decide, I will not get to know God. I do not believe. I will not believe. I refuse to for whatever reason. And I don't think that it's necessarily that God says, you know, like, I refuse to let you in. I think it's more like he's saying, all right, well, the veil has to stay then. You know, I'm not going to lift it for you. And so when I read this, you know, and it talked about, let's see, I think in verse 4, in their case, the God of this world has blinded their minds, the unbelievers, to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel. You know, that's where I feel like he's saying the gospel is veiled. That's where he's talking about people keeping a veil over their eyes. And so this week, what I was thinking about with that, something that really hurts my heart when it comes to people who just don't want to see Christ and don't want a relationship with God is how bad I want it for them. And the thing is, if you know people, or maybe it's yourself, that struggle with believing in God and don't really want to, or they don't think it's real or whatever, you know that they're not happy. That's the thing that I typically see is that these people that refuse to love God, there's some kind of hurt within them and they are not happy in the situation that they're in. And so the first thing I kind of want to talk about for this week, if you haven't been here before, what I kind of try to do is take each of these sections and kind of teach us something that we can use for the week. So like for this week, one of my goals is going to be to start trying to talk to the people that I realize have a veil over their eyes. If I have a veil over my eyes on certain things, I want to be shown that. But also, there are so many people that I'm friends with that I know have a veil over their eyes right now to the gospel, and they don't really want to know God right now, or they just don't care to. And so this week, I'm wanting to do that. I'm wanting to help them see that, not by telling them, you know, like, hey, you're wrong, you need to love God, but by showing them godly love. We talk a lot about godly love in these Bible studies, and I truly believe that that is the one way that we can bring people to Christ. So if you have someone in your family, maybe it's a spouse that's just not into the whole God thing. Maybe it's a friend, family member, whatever it is, you know, it's up to us to continue to try to lift that veil by showing them the way that Christ loves us. And, you know, last week we talked a lot about relationships. I wish I would have saved that when it was the only video I haven't saved. But I'm going to be posting an IGTV on Monday on some of the stuff that I talked about in that live last week. But that's something that I have just felt convicted about, is showing people love in a way that makes them desire to lift the veil so they will get to know Christ. It's not going to be something that's easy or that just happens overnight. I know I had a friend in college when we kind of went our separate ways just because I was trying to get to know God again, and that my group of friends wasn't. So I had to go my own separate ways. But after about a year, one of my friends came back and said, hey girl, you know, I just noticed a difference in you, and I don't really know what exactly it is, but you're just so happy now and you're so good on your own. I want to know what that is. Yeah, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is like the one time in my life that I've ever been like, huh, it's Jesus. You know, it's cheesy as that kind of sounds to people. I'm like, no, but really, it's like I I get it now. You know, come with me, like come to church with me next Sunday. Let's talk about it. You know, and within 3 months she was saved. And I think that that is something so cool. And that didn't happen overnight. That didn't happen for me pestering her every day. What made that happen was because I was so in love with my relationship with Jesus that love shown out of me. Last Wednesday, I think I talked about how we could be blinding depending on the amount of Jesus we choose to reflect. And that is, I feel like, what happened in that situation. And that's what I think we are called to do as Christians, is not to give up on anybody, not say, oh, that person, they're not going to get saved because they don't get it. But to actually come to these people and show them love and sit down with them, eat with them, invite them over, do life with them. And as we do life with them, they'll want to know more. Then they'll want to see it. Then they may get it, right? So then moving on, moving down to, let's see, all of 6-9. So, but we have this treasure, right? For God, who said, let light shine out of darkness, has shown in our hearts to give the light of knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying the body, the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may be manifested in our bodies. That is one of my absolute favorite chunks of scripture in the Bible. There's several different ones, pieces that I love like that. But the reason I love that is because I've always loved the idea of our relationship with Christ being a light, right? I love that he always refers to us as a light within darkness, a lamp on a hill. You know, you can name so many references to light. My late husband and I are actually, when we got married, our theme was the light, because we wanted our relationship and ourselves to be a light to others. We wanted Christ to use us to be a light. And so we made everything about light. And I think about too, I love the idea of our bodies. Like, so if you are just now getting into your faith, you may not understand, for we have these things in jars of clay. Jars of clay are representing us, our hearts, and our that ability to be molded, because clay obviously can be heated up and molded. And so that is kind of what he's saying here. Right now, we are jars of clay that he can mold and that he can use, and he can put a light within this. Whenever we think of things this way, when we can think of our heart in that way, we can think about, you know, what heats up clay. That would be heat. That would be fire. You know, and I think about that as far as the next part, when it says we were afflicted in every way, but not crushed. And it talks about all these things. We're in despair, we're forsaken, not struck down, not destroyed. And it takes me back to when I lost my late husband. You know, that obviously that was one of the hardest things I've ever gone through in my life, if not the hardest. And one thing that I thought a lot about was my heart being a jar of clay. I thought a lot about how this situation, which basically was a fire underneath me, and what I could either do is allow that clay just to be melted and broken, or I could allow God to use that heat and that fire, this fire that I was in, to mold me into something, into a light, into a lamp that he could put a light within and show it to others. And that's what I believe he wants for all of us. When hardships happen, because they happen to every single one of us, and they will always happen. I know that God doesn't want that to make us succumb to our circumstance and be struck down. Let's see, it says, you know, like, he doesn't want us to be crushed. He doesn't want us to be forsaken. He doesn't want us to be struck down and destroyed. He doesn't want those things. What I believe he wants is for us to allow that heat, that fire that we're facing, to mold us into something great, where that Jesus could live within and be shown to others. You know, I was reading about Daniel and, you know, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and all those people. And I was thinking about the story. If you haven't read it, that's okay. Don't worry about it. But so Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego get thrown into fire by Nebuchadnezzar because they won't bow, right? They won't bow to his idols. And so they get thrown into this fire, which would be terrifying, like a huge furnace. And Jesus shows up in that situation. Everyone sees that there's another angel. Well, it says the angel of the Lord, but, you know, there's discrepancy if that's Jesus or an angel or whatever. I think it's Jesus. But So it shows him, and they get to spend time with him, and everyone is shown through this terrible situation, wow, the God of the universe cares about these people, and he's real. Okay, now fast forward to the New Testament, and there's Peter. And Peter is sitting there seeing Jesus across the water, and he's like, oh my gosh, that's Jesus, I need to get out. And he gets out of the water, he's looking at him, he's walking, and then he looks down at the water, and he succumbs to it, right? And I see both of these as kind of examples of what it's talking about here. You know, we can look at these situations and we can say, okay, I'm facing a terrifying moment in my life, something that is absolutely, I don't think I can make it through, right? Like for me, losing my husband, sitting there in the police station, waiting to hear if they found him or not the first day before we were searching for him for 7. You know, I remember sitting there and thinking, all right, I can handle this 2 different ways. Am I gonna let the fire change me and grow me and allow Jesus to show up and people to see Christ? Or am I going to look at my circumstance and succumb to it, and therefore Jesus just has to save me and can't use me to save others, right? That's where I see the differences. Both Jesus loves us and is gonna get us through every single thing that goes on in our life. But one allows God to use us. The other only allows him to help us. And I don't know, I had something in me that just said, I want to be that person that helps others, not just asking God to help me. And that is what I think, you know, a lot of this chapter, and if you've read 2 Corinthians in full, what it's talking about. It's talking about strengthening your faith to the point that when these situations happen, because it's not if they happen, it's when they happen. When they happen, can we hold tight to Jesus and say, all right, God, I'll let you mold my heart. I'll let you mold my heart like a jar of clay. I'll let you make it into a lamp for others and shine it out, because I know with Jesus, I am not afflicted. I know that I'm not struck down. I know that I'm not destroyed. Will we hold on to that? Or will we go back to the, I can't do this. God, if you loved me, you wouldn't do this to me. If you loved me, this wouldn't have happened. You know, there's 2 different ways that we can look at things. And I know that it's easy to fall into that, God, why would you do this to me? But there's something so strong and powerful about saying, God, whatever happens, I will choose to love you no matter what. No matter what happens, whatever gets taken away, whatever my story is, I will choose to love you unconditionally. And that kind of unconditional love does something so powerful within us. And I honestly believe that's the only way I got through what I got through, was because I allowed him to change me and use me versus saying, God, why me? Why me? I will push away from you because I don't know why you're doing this to me. So then, let's see. Let's skip down to, grace extends more and more, people may increase thanksgiving. So let's look at 15. So it talks about thanksgiving, and then in 16 it says, so do we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For the light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. As we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things unseen, for the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. So this kind of goes back to whatever you're experiencing. Maybe you don't have to experience losing a spouse or something devastating to feel like you're losing heart, to feel like you're being broken down. That's something that I was used to be a teacher at a private school, and all the kids used to say, you know, like, I just haven't gone through anything yet. Like, I don't know if I really trust God or believe fully because I've never been really tested yet. But then yet I could see them so many days being so upset, you know, in fights with people, you know, other people in the hallways or whatever, not like fights like physical, but fights like, you know, mad at each other, and being so upset by these things and letting it really define who they are. And it made me realize, you know, it doesn't have to be something tragic to feel like you're losing heart and to feel depressed in life and to feel just so down. You know, it doesn't have to be. It could be that you're struggling, you and your relation, you and your spouse are struggling, or maybe you are single and you're really wanting to meet somebody, or maybe you're just struggling with body image, or whatever it is, put in whatever you're struggling with right now. That's something that can cause us to lose heart and to hurt and to wonder why our lives are this way. And that's what, when I think about this part, you know, it starts with, you know, a grace extends to more and more people, and it may increase thanksgiving. The thanksgiving part here, and I talk about a lot about this, and I talk about this in my book a lot. Giving thanks and thanksgiving is the only way, and I'm not talking about, again, I talk about things sometimes and I just assume people understand what I'm talking about. So thanksgiving doesn't mean the holiday. Thanksgiving means just like giving thanks to God. But thanksgiving, giving thanks, those things are so hard to do when we're in those moments that we feel crushed and we feel forsaken. We feel like we're just holding the weight of the world, or our emotions are hurting us so bad. This past week, we talked about emotional health and the importance of that for spiritual health and how both of those bleed into one another. When I think about Thanksgiving and thanks and giving thanks, when we do that, I feel like I've said this before, but I'll say it again, that a thankful heart, it overcomes a heart that's full of sorrow. Like sadness and hurt and pain cannot live in the same heart that of thankfulness. So basically, something I've been trying to do when I'm down, when I'm hurting, when I'm feeling like, oh, things are lost or whatever, is saying, okay, God, I'm going to say things that I'm thankful for. I'm going to remind myself the things that I should be thankful for, versus focusing on these things I can't control, this emotion that's taking over me. And the more I remind myself of things that I'm thankful for, the more I calm down, the more that my emotions calm down, the more that I realize I have so much more to be thankful for than I do to be upset about, right? And so that's why I say where a thankful heart is, a sorrowful heart, an angry heart can't be there also. Together, those things can help heal us. And so that is where I come over here. When we have a thankful heart, that means we won't lose heart, because when we start feeling down, we'll realize, you know, if I really think about it, I can remember and I can think of all these ways that God's helped me. I also say a lot, we have to remember so we don't forget. We have to remember what God's done for us so that we don't forget in these moments that are hard, right? So though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. And I'm sure you've felt that before. Moments where you've just felt like, I don't know if I'm going to make it. I am so desperately sad, or I am broken, or I'm hurting, or I am just making decisions I don't want to make, or whatever. You know, we have these moments where we feel like we're just wasting away. Like, I am broken. I can't do anything, you know, and when we do choose instead to allow God to use those moments, like I said earlier, to shape our hearts, to shape our jars of clay and put a light within it, then even though our outside is wasting away, the inside can be renewed day by day. And every day it will get better. Every day will grow stronger. And, you know, like, you can take this, like, wasting away, like, two different ways. I mean, I've heard it, you know, just, like, we're actually physically wasting away. But I kind of like this of looking at it as, you know, sometimes when we're in certain situations, when we feel broken, we truly feel like our outside, our hearts, everything about us is wasting away. And instead of allowing that to consume us, when we allow Jesus's death and what he did for us and all those things to remind us what we can be thankful for, then we can be renewed and better. And I hope that my story, if you've read it before, if you know it, or if you've heard it before, I hope that that shows you, you know, from being broken and losing my husband from two and a half, three years ago. You know, when I think about that, where I was and how broken I was, to today, sitting in my new home with my husband, Andrew, who's sitting in the back room, probably listening to me right now. You know, when I think about that and just how God healed so many things, I can't help but look at him and say, thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you for allowing my heart to be renewed day by day, even though I felt like my outside self may not get up in the morning. Thank you for helping me when I didn't know if I could make it through a work day. Thank you, God, for helping me when I was by myself with all my friends and their husbands, or during holidays or whatever. God, thank you for renewing my heart every single day to get me to this point. Because eventually, one day, he will work things out for our good. And so I just kind of want to end on this last part. For the light momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. You know, something that I will say, and I'll end on this. You know, in the moment, it doesn't feel momentary when you're going through something hard. And again, like I said, it doesn't have to be losing a spouse. It can be, you know, it may seem like little to you, but it may just be like right now I'm having financial issues, or maybe my car's messed up, or maybe, like, you know, I'm struggling with having kids, or name it. You know, it might be something very personal to you that maybe not a lot of people know that you're struggling with. And in the moment, it doesn't feel like a momentary affliction. It feels like it's an all-consuming fire. But I just want to encourage you today to say, when we trust fully in God, when we fully trust Him to take care of us in every single situation, the anxiety that we feel from day to day can subside. When we truly decide to say, God, I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I don't know what's going to happen today. I don't know how I'm ever going to get out of this. But what I'm going to choose to do is spend time with you, pray, try to make good decisions, read my Bible, listen to you when I can, you know, hear what you're trying to tell me to do. But I'm just going to walk through this pain with you. And day by day, I promise you, as from someone who's gone through it, every day, twice, I mean, I talk about this with my transformational period, not just losing my husband, but also with my walk with Christ, how hard it was to go from who I was before and the decisions I was making to becoming something new. That was a struggle. I mean, I felt like I was on a battleground, just like climbing through. And every day I came closer, and every day it got better. Maybe I didn't see it, but eventually I got to a point where I got to the top of the mountain. I looked back and I said, wow, I did all that. I got through all that. God helped me all the way. And I realized that it was just a momentary affliction. And I was stronger now, and I'm a better person now because of it. So I want to encourage you today to say, try that this week. Try to trust God that wherever you're at, however bad it is, God, I'll go through the trenches with you. I'll walk through it. I will trust you. I will choose to trust you and love you no matter what. No matter how hard the day is, I will always come back to you. And I promise, if you'll look back, journal it down. Journal, I'm a big firm believer in journaling, but when you look back 6 months, a year from now, if you'll take on that perspective, you'll be so thankful you did. And I promise you, your situation will be better. But I hope that I encourage you today, friends. That's basically all I have to say on 2 Corinthians. So this week, let's partake from this. First, let's be a light to others. Let's be an example of Christ to others, no matter what, not telling them what they're doing wrong, but showing them what Christ looks like and opening those doors to possible conversations about it. Another thing that I think is important just on that is knowing why you believe what you believe. That's something that I've taken time to do, is sit down and write out, like, why do I believe this? What do I believe about Jesus? So that I can articulate my beliefs. Being able to articulate your beliefs gives you the confidence to be able to do it. And I'm a firm believer that the Spirit will help you talk anyway, but it helps you be more confident to know why you believe what you believe. So we're going to do that. And then we're going to decide, God, when I feel pressured in this moment or in the future, I'm going to allow you to make my heart like a jar of clay, to mold me into a lamp for others, to mold me into something that can be used by you, to know that I am not crushed, that I am not afflicted, that I'm not struck down, but I can get through this momentary affliction and find so much happiness on the other side of it. But I hope that helps you guys. I know it helped me. It's helping me just to remember that everything is a momentary affliction. We can get through it. We can get through it the next day. You know, I know it's a lot easier said than done, but I truly, truly hope that you can take a moment and say, I will dedicate 6 months to a year to this and see how far I come. There's no way you'll regret it, and I hope that you'll do that with me.